I'm Deborah Reed, WKTV Managing Editor, and you are watching WKTV Journal Soundbites. We are here today with Peter Baker, the New York Times Chief White House Correspondent. Welcome, Peter.
Thanks for having me. Looking forward to it.
So, working for the Washington Post and now the New York Times, you have become a nationally acclaimed journalist. So, at what age was your interest in journalism sparked, and what or who sparked that interest?
I was very lucky. I was one of the lucky ones. I knew early on what I wanted to do, and I was very lucky to get a chance to do it. I wanted to be a journalist from third grade. My teacher, Mrs. Van Vliet, made me the editor of the third grade paper. We printed them out on, you remember those purple, forget what they call those. And I loved it so much that I always thought I wanted to do it. And I was lucky to have a chance to do it. So
that's great.
Yeah.
And your wife, Susan Glasser, is also a journalist and has also worked at the Washington Post and some various other places. So talk about the dynamics about both of you working in the same field, and you write books together. So how much of your professional lives spill into your personal lives?
Yeah, it's a fairly seamless kind of thing there. There's not really a border between one and the other. But, you know, that's how we met. We met in a newsroom. We met at the newsroom of the Washington Post. She was my editor on the national desk when I was covering President Clinton. And we got to know each other over the Clinton impeachment and the investigation by Ken Starr. So, you know, we in effect started our relationship as a professional relationship and evolved into a more 360 degree kind of relationship. So when we write books together, when we work together, it's not new or unusual. That's how we've always done it. And we're very lucky to have that opportunity.
I say it really is to have that type of relationship where you just mesh so well in all aspects of life. That's great. And your son Theo, has also become a journalist and has cut his teeth on the Stanford Daily, has already won the George Polk Special Award and the James Madison Freedom of Information Award. So you must be pretty proud of him.
We are proud of him. We always thought he always told us he was never going to be a reporter, though. So it's a little bit of a surprise to us. He went off to college, wanted to go to Stanford because, you know, they do a lot of great computer science stuff there. He had a lot of things he was interested in. And then one day he calls and says, yeah, I think I'm going to work for the student paper. And we said, OK, sure. And then a couple of weeks later, he calls and says, I'm investigating the president of the university. Like, oh, my gosh. So he really has made a mark on his own, I think, despite not because of his parents.
That's great. And so kind of going back to you, what has drawn you toward the political side of journalism? Because there are several aspects that you can report on. So what about the political field interests you so much?
Well, I love history, and I love the opportunity to see history up close. I have a first row seat, in effect, at history as it's playing out. And at the White House, you have that. It's this is my fifth president that I've covered, and every one of them has been fascinating and absorbing and challenging. And of course, for a reporter, you know, I mean, reporting is just the best job in the world. It's so much better than working for a living. You get to actually go out and meet people and travel to places you otherwise would never go and explore issues and subjects that kind of catch your interest. And the White House beat in particular is even more so, because every kind of issue comes in front of the president of the United States, whether it be healthcare, race relations, foreign policy, national security, cyber issues, all of these things at some point or another come through the White House. And you get to learn about all these different subjects as part of your work.
Wonderful. And I agree, being in journalism as well, I tell people one of my favorite things is being able to talk to people and help them tell their stories and to learn about them. So,
absolutely, absolutely. And what a gift, you know. I mean, we're not stuck in an office. We're not stuck, you know, at a work site. We move around. We get to learn every day. It's like professional learning for a lifetime.
Yes. And with newspapers disappearing throughout the country over the past decade, because we know digital media is still full force and growing, but newspapers have been disappearing a little bit, and journalists have been finding other professions and people are going to unconventional news sources. So give us your assessment of the state of journalism today and what your hopes for the future of journalism might be.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I think journalism is both in a state of crisis and in a golden era at the same time. And that sounds counterintuitive, but both these things can be true. It's in crisis because we're trying to figure out how to reinvent ourselves for the modern era, to adapt our business model so that we can continue to do the stories that we have always done. It's a golden era in the sense that while there's a lot of, a lot of loss, newspapers that have folded or scaled back their ambition, at the same time, as you rightly say, digital journalism, new journalism is on the rise, and it's a period of innovation and entrepreneurship where people can be creative and experiment and try new things and find different ways to get across information to viewers and readers. And that's very exciting to watch a new organization come out of nowhere and suddenly within a year or two challenge the New York Times or the Washington Post or any other legacy news outlet in a very competitive and meaningful way. And so I think that it's both an exciting and a scary time in the business, and it's not for the faint of heart.
Yes. Well, and kind of going along with that, what do you see as the biggest void in news since it is more digital now versus the print newspaper? And what might some of the dangers of that void be, and how can we rectify those?
Yeah, what worries me most is not the national news scene, because I think that there, for every organization that has pulled back from national news, something new has come along and filled that void. There's a lot of very talented reporters here in Washington, a lot of very ambitious news outlets. What worries me are local and state news organizations and local and state news. And I got my start in local news, covering cops and courts and school boards and all of that. And then I went to Richmond in Virginia as the state capital. So that's my origin. And I feel very worried that the diminishment of coverage of those places means that Americans aren't getting the kind of information they should get about their local communities and their states and what the people who they elect are doing with the power or the money that the electorate give them. And I think it's a problem for democracy, because an informed vote, only the best of voters are informed voters, and if nobody's there to inform them because they can't afford the journalism, then they're not necessarily equipped to make the best choices. So what I think the business has to do is figure out a way to take the energy and entrepreneurship and innovation at the national level and bring it more and more to the states. And I hear of exciting ideas that people are working on in that regard, and I hope that they make a lot of progress, but that would be where I worry the most.
Okay. Yeah. And you, like you said, you've covered the last five United States presidents and their administrations, and you've reported on topics ranging from domestic to economic and political and even national security. You commented in a 2023 forum that reporters in the White House press room really only know about 25% of what's actually happening in the White House.
I was probably being generous.
Well, and you also said that most of what's learned about a presidential administration is discovered after that administration has concluded through studies and interviews and forums. So what do you feel is the importance of looking back on those previous presidential administrations and learning about them?
Well, I think when I said that, what I meant was that a White House obviously only is willing to tell us so much at a time, and reporters are able to learn only so much at a time through their digging and investigation. Obviously, we try to learn 100%, but inevitably we only scratch the surface because it's not a transparent organization. It never has been, and it certainly won't be in the future. And I think there's a value in going back. This is why I enjoy doing books, going back and sort of revisiting some of the topics that I did cover in real time to discover how much I didn't know what was going on behind the scenes. And what you see is after a presidency is over, after people have left the White House, they're often much more willing to talk more candidly, more forthrightly, more openly than they were at the time, because there's not a consequence of a headline in tomorrow's paper that's going to cause them some problem. Instead, they're eager to help set the tone for history, because they understand that we need to have a fuller, richer picture of what presidents do and what the people around them do. And so you learn all kinds of things you didn't really understand at the time. And I started off with a book about Clinton's impeachment, And the book we're working on right now, my wife and I, is a book about the last five presidents and how they dealt with Putin. And I think, you know, I can't think of anything that would be too much more important about how do we get to this point where we're in a proxy war, in effect, in the middle of Europe with a nuclear armed adversary. And so going back and revisiting that, how do we go from the jubilance of the post-Cold War era to the moment now when we're worried about, you know, a great deal of violence in the heart of Europe? That's an important subject to try to revisit.
Yeah, definitely. I think learning from history is a very important thing to do, to know how to move forward and also the important things not to move back to.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And when you are come to the Gerald R. Ford Museum here in Grand Rapids, you're going to be speaking on covering the vice presidency and lessons learned down the road. So do you feel that studying the vice presidency is just as important as studying the office of president? And if so, why?
Well, not as important, but it definitely is more important than I think people recognize, right? And that we collectively, the journalism and political communities and worlds, ought to know more about our vice presidents. Because in fact, a large number of them ultimately become president, either because of the vacancy in the office or because they run for the office later. And I think that's going to be especially important in this coming year, this election year that we're in, because we have two candidates who are 81 and 77. And by definition, therefore, the chances of a vice president ascending to the office or having to figure out what to do about the office are even greater than they've ever been. So it is a tough job. It's a job that your power is entirely derivative of the president that you serve. And, you know, your only duties are to preside over the Senate as the president of the Senate and break ties there, and to show up in the Oval Office every day and take the president's temperature and see how he's doing. Right. So it's not an easy job. And almost every person who's had it, I think, has complained about it. My favorite quote is Thomas Marshall. He was the vice president for Woodrow Wilson. He once said there were two brothers, one went to sea and one became vice president and neither was heard from again. And I think that tells you a little bit about the nature of the job and why it's not very pleasant, but it's also so critical. John Adams said it's the worst job ever invented by constitutional framers. I am nothing and yet I may yet be everything. And that sort of captures it.
Wow. Yeah, I had not thought of it quite that way, and I had not realized that so many vice presidents had that feeling. So, yeah, wow. So what are some of the overarching similarities you have seen between presidential administrations?
Well, it's interesting, you know, if you put Trump aside, because I think Trump is sui generis, the other four White Houses that I have covered, and I've written about a couple other ones in books, so really six, seven of them that I've spent a lot of time studying, they're a lot more alike than you think, because the rhythms of the job, the choices that are available to you, the nature of the challenges, the constrictions on their ability to get things done, the factors that go into a White House are pretty familiar from one to the next, regardless of whether you're Republican or Democrat. You know, it's the issues often, you know, the issues I'm covering today are some of the same issues I covered almost 30 years ago, 28 years ago, when I first started at the White House in 1996. They have evolved and they have changed, but a lot of them are still pretty similar there. And therefore, also the choices available to presidents. I remember we asked, I didn't ask, but one of President George W. Bush's aides asked him at the end of his presidency, "What surprised you about being president?" And he said, "How little power I have." And Barack Obama gave almost the exact same answer when he was leaving office. What was the most thing that surprised you? He says, you know, how hard it is in effect to get things done. Because we assume a president can do everything. We cover them. It's a function of our media to some extent that we cover them so intensely. It gives the public the impression that they're almost like kings, eventually a queens. But in fact, there are constraints on their power that are significant. Congress, the courts, the bureaucratic agencies, the media, politics generally. And I think that the disparity, the dichotomy between the impression that a president is all powerful and the reality of the job is something that is a consistency throughout them all.
Okay. That's very interesting, because you do tend to think, or at least I do personally, yes, that they do have the power to accomplish what they what they want to in those 4 years, and then realizing that's not true is, quite different. So what have you seen that tends to vary the most from administration to administration?
That's an excellent question. Obviously, Republican Democrats are going to have different positions on issues, right? What's interesting in some ways are the different personalities of the presidents, I suppose, right? That they're not, that you assume that they're all like great politicians to be there, but some of them don't really like politics, actually. Some of them aren't necessarily very good at that. Some are strong in this way or strong in that way. You have extroverts, you have introverts, you have people who are really very bright in an intellectual way and others who are bright in an emotional way. I was talking with somebody yesterday. We were talking about the difference between Bill Clinton and Barack Obama. And this person described them, I thought pretty accurately, said that Obama is a cat and Bill Clinton is a dog. The cat doesn't really care, frankly, whether you like them or not. The cat's kind of cool, does his or her thing, very much into him or herself and self-contained. It doesn't need the validation of the owner or the other animals. A dog, at least many dogs, my dog, like Bill Clinton, loves to be loved, wants people to like them, and makes a real point of appealing to them, and has a real visceral connection to people or other dogs. And so, even though you have these two Democrats who were pretty significant players in the last 25 years in the White House, in terms of personality, couldn't be more different. But Bill Clinton loved a crowd. If you put him in the East Room with a crowd, he loved it. He got energized from it. He came out of the meeting, he came out of the event pumped up. If you put Barack Obama in the same room, he would do what he had to do. And he could be very charming and inspirational at times, but it drained him. And his staff knew that they had to give him 5 minutes in his schedule before heading into another thing. So he kind of recharged his batteries a little bit. So each president is different a little bit in that sense.
Okay, wonderful. And talking about journalism itself, a core value is commitment to fairness while in pursuit of the truth. And as we know, politics can be an extremely polarizing subject. So how does that fundamental value of journalism outlast the pressures of constantly changing administrations?
It's hard, and you're right to point that out. Our job is to be as I like the word independent these days. I think I've given up a little bit on the word objective because it just sparks arguments. It's fair to say that no human being is objective because we all bring our personal experiences to the table on any issue or any experience. But I think therefore maybe independence is the best word to describe what I think journalists should be, at least reporters. I mean, again, columnists are allowed to express opinions, but a beat reporter like myself should try not to be not to take sides, not to go into any story with preconceived notions, to follow the facts as best as possible. And it is a huge challenge in today's polarized times because people don't trust the media, a lot of them, or only trust media that tell them what they want to think or what they already believe. And that's not our job. Our job is to present people with whatever we can determine to be the facts. Bob Woodward likes to call it the best obtainable version of the truth that you can get by deadline. And therefore flawed, but as factual and truth-based as possible without, putting our foot on the scale one way or the other because we happen to have a personal opinion. In today's era, there's not as much, it feels like that's not valued as much, but I think those old-fashioned journalistic values are more important than ever in a polarized era so that people have can go to the New York Times, I would hope, and say, well, I may not always agree with everything they say on their editorial page, but I know I can trust the news columns because they're not trying to shape the events or trying to cover them.
Yeah, and I think that trust is very important. So how has your job as a journalist evolved as administrations have evolved, and what also remains constant throughout that evolution?
I mean, I would say, look, every president goes frustrated with the media and they express that in various ways. That has always been the case. And that's true whether it's, again, Republican or Democrat. I've never met a White House yet that liked, what we do. Some of them are better humored about it than others. But broadly speaking, they get frustrated with the press. And that's okay. That goes with the territory. The one outlier, of course, was former President Trump, who didn't just dislike what the press did. He went further by saying phrases like enemies of the people or fake news or things like that, which I think, unfortunately, were aimed at discrediting the very idea of a free press. And that's different. That's not a Republican or Democrat thing. That's a unique to him kind of thing. And I think that's a little bit more concerning for us, because in effect, what he's saying to the public is, don't trust anything that they say. In fact, he was asked that once by Leslie Stahl from 60 Minutes. She says, why do you always attack reporters like that? And he says, because I know, because one day you'll write something I don't like, and I want to discredit you so people won't believe you. Mm-hmm. And it's a strategy to undercut our credibility. And I understand why he's doing it, but I also think that there's some that's a dangerous thing for a free society.
Yeah, for sure. Well, Peter, thank you for joining us today on WKTV Journal Soundbites, for sharing your passion for journalism. And this has definitely been very informative and eye-opening. So thank you.
Thank you for having me. I can't wait to visit.
For more information on covering the vice presidency, lessons learned on the road, visit the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Museum website. For more local news, visit our website, wktvjournal.org. This is Deborah Reed with WKTV Journal Soundbites.